first of all, I want to welcome our first keynote speaker, Mrs. Lina Kushch. We know her very well. She also had a wonderful talk on Tuesday about journalists under pressure. So welcome, Mrs. Lina Kushch, who is the first secretary of the Ukrainian Journalists Union.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity to take part in the discussion on this topic, because as Ukrainian journalist, I have my own observation and my own experience concerning Russian and Russia language media in Ukraine. First of all, I want to talk about the Russian language media in Ukraine. Last year, we adopted a new law on language, according to which TV and radio organization broadcast in Ukrainian, and print media must be published in Ukrainian too. At the same time, the print media may be published in other languages, and printing publication must be simultaneously with the relevant printing in Ukrainian. This law came into force in 2.5 years for the national and regional print media, and in 5 years for the local print media. So the local media have enough time to prepare for this, improving this law. Online media must have Ukrainian version. It's a strong obligation, and according to this law, many online media, national online media, especially hired this year's translators or proofreaders in Ukraine for Ukrainian version, and the other ones use machine translating only. As to Russia media in Ukraine, from 2014, Russia media has banned in Ukraine, Russia TV channel. And since 2016, many online sources, such as social media like Odnoklassniki and ВКонтакте or Yandex or Mail.ru, banned in by Ukrainian authority. I don't think it's an unprecedented decision, because, for example, we know that Russia Today and Sputnik were banned in Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia as well. We remember serious accusations were made by their state regulator in Great Britain and such other. But is it enough to defeat Russia propaganda? Not, it isn't. I would like to know that Russia invests many huge money into the propaganda system, both in the country and abroad. Ukraine doesn't have a similar state-controlled media system, because not only because it's very expensive, but also because our country has a different level of freedom of speech and different level of democracy in general. For example, there were no state-controlled local media since 2019 in Ukraine, since we finished the reform of local media. And in the Russia, the owner of most local newspapers is the government, as we know. In Ukraine, there is no such control over the online media, over social networks, like it's carried in Russia by Roskomnadzor. It's in a democracy country, it's impossible to imagine this structure for control. After the authorities' decision to ban Russia TV channels and Russia social media, we can see that information war moved to the Ukrainian media, to the Ukrainian segment of social media, of social space. We can see that Russia propaganda fuels contradiction between social groups in Ukraine or between regions in Ukraine. And polarizes Ukrainian society. I could see it in 2014 in Donetsk, where I lived and worked till 2014 as a Ukrainian journalist. I consider that the fact that the Ukrainian segment of the internet is switching to the Ukrainian language is it a positive fact. This is both the requirement from law and the requirement from our audience who wants to be able to read the news in their native language. Indeed, most sites are focused on topics of interest to readers from Ukraine and no seek to provide information in other languages for audience abroad audience, for foreign colleagues and readers. And it's my third note. European media and European journalists, and Germany is no exception, receive information about Ukraine from Russia source. Because Russia makes sure make that information is available in all languages, but Ukrainian media, a few Ukrainian media have English or German version. For example, our news agency, national news agencies like Ukrinform or Union, Ukrainian News and Interfax. Maybe that's all. From 204 from Orange Revolution in Ukraine, we can see that many international media are still covering Ukrainian topics via the regional offices in Moscow. Because I can see and I can read the Russian narratives in European media. For example, that we have civil conflicts on the east of Ukraine in Donbass. This is conflict between local citizens and the government in Kyiv, or between local citizens and the other citizens from other region in Ukraine. Russia not a party of this conflict, and to end these hostiles, the authorities in Kyiv should negotiate directly with the de facto government on the occupied territories. It's typically view for Russia media, and I can read it in many European media too. I have I remember one case in 2014 when one foreign journalist from Moscow came to Donetsk. The journalist was cameraman, he worked for international media in Moscow bureau, and I showed him our city, and it started confrontations in Donetsk, and my colleague asked me, should I, can you film this man through the defense? Can this policeman be filmed? Or do we need a shooting permit in a shopping center and such other? It was strange for me. It was I was surprised of these questions. And I asked him, why do you ask me? You are a journalist. You have the right to film, to shoot, or to fix all you can see. He said, "I'm sorry. I'm just from Moscow, and it's a habit in Moscow for journalists." This is our huge difference, maybe. Russian media maybe have more money to shoot bright and expensive projects, but Ukrainian colleagues have more freedom, I think. And to effectively combat Russian propaganda in Ukraine, it's not enough just to ban Russian media or Russian sources, such as sources of lies and misinformation. It's important to build your own information space, increase trust in your own media, and cooperate with international media and with you journalists from the other countries. A war of the problem of external propaganda, journalists must refrain from becoming propagandists themselves. Our job is to provide to the audience verified information and quality journalism work. Thank you very much for your attention, and I can answer your question. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Lina Kushch. Does anyone have any questions for Mrs. Kushch? I want to comment on something she said in her keynote speech.
Yes, may I?
Yes, sure.
Lina, please tell me, does it mean that these ban on Russian language usage will cover also Ukrainian registered media? So is it, will it be possible for Ukrainian nationals to run a website or newspaper in Russian language?
Yes, we have Russian language sites in Ukraine, and they have Russia version and Ukrainian version. For example, some of them have English version. It's Russia language sites and Russia language newspapers aren't banned in Ukraine. Yes, it's allowed, but they have to have a Ukrainian version too.
Okay, thank you for the clarification, because there are many people who are confused by this regulation, and I wanted you to say it clear and loud. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for your interest.
So, is there another question for Mrs. Lina Kushch? I don't see any. You can just wave or write your question into the chat as always. Okay, so no more questions. Thank you very much for your time, Mrs. Lina Kushch. Are you gone now? No, I don't see her anymore. But thank you very much for your words and for your time.